So, I think we've been pretty well through the rules of procedure, but I wanted to, I think we almost got to the end of it, and I wanted to make sure that, any other conversation that we wanted to have. So here's an update.
Is John gone?
And
When was Paul, did you hear from Paul?
Paul's not coming.
I did hear, Paul is not coming. Ken, I apologize, this one may not be a full copy.
It's okay, I do have it.
Oh, okay.
I think this is rather good.
Good. And, because what seems to have happened is I got more than the number of copies I ordered up, but all of the copies, or many of the copies are missing pages 6 and 7, or parts of pages 6 and 7. Which
does that matter? Oh, six, is 6 not a full page? Oh, I just realized that, but 6 only has D, and then 7 has C and D.
Okay, so it must be a page break.
So it must be a page break. Okay, so it's a page break issue. Okay.
Okay, so.
So you may have completed.
I can't blame the printer. I can blame the outboard that's good enough. And then, one of the things that Sarah and I discussed briefly was updating our forms. OSI has provided sample forms that break. Currently, the ZBA has a single form for all. It only mentions 3 of the 4 possible bases of action for the Zoning Board of Appeal. It doesn't mention equitable waiver. And what OSI has recommended is to have to break out the application into 4 separate forms that could be available for applicants on the website. And then the last thing on the agenda, which we may or may not get to, this is information that John Radigan, who is the attorney who works for the town on zoning issues, shared with us for free. And if we have some time, we can begin going through that material. The other thing that we had to do tonight was to talk about training dates. The select board on Monday night approved a sum of money of $550 for us to get training from the Hampshire Municipal Association. And we have 3 dates in mind that they would be available. So we want to see what gets us the best bang for our buck on getting that training. Hoping we'll either be done by 8:30 or your pleasure whether we extend the meeting till 9. Do you need
some? No.
So I guess we can talk about rules of procedure first. Are there questions or comments or suggestions for additional changes to the...
It's pretty much what we discussed the last time, isn't it?
It is. I made those updates.
Yeah.
Additional change that I made when we looked at item 18, P as in Putnam, the suggested language from the OSI manual had been the chairperson shall present a summary, and as we talked about it, I think the board felt that that's a big demand to put on the chair to adequately summarize what could be a fairly complex hearing. At the same time, it may be helpful for the board if the chair is able to make a summary for the chair to make that effort. So I decided to leave it in, subject to additional conversation with you all, and have it as may So there's, it's not that somebody can say if I'm overwhelmed and can't, you know, say I just can't provide you a summary, you'll have to rely on your memory. It's not that there would be a procedural error in our process because I failed to provide a summary, but if I'm able to do it, if the board finds it helpful, it's one of the things that the board says, yeah, if you can do it, maybe helpful to us. So that was the one change that I had to discuss. Anything else?
I just wanted to talk about 19 decisions. So this does state that we have 30 days of the close of the public hearing to make our decision. Now, the five business days, is that the five will, let's see, the decision will be made available for public inspection within 5 business days after the 30 days? Okay. That was one of the questions that I was kind of mulling over as far as when we hear a matter that we're not required to decide that evening, that we will have a period of time.
Well, we can look at this presentation a little bit. One of the reasons why I was hoping that we could get some outside training is I think you put your finger on an important question. Mm-hmm. Because the statute and the guidance that we have from OSI seems to suggest that we close the hearing and then deliberate in public about the matter and take a vote. And that's how historically the ZBA has done it, as I understand. But there's also these statutes that say that the written decision can follow within 30 days. And so just exactly how that process works, I have some questions about. Mm. Some of you.
Yeah, you call me, you and me. We never deliberated. We had an opportunity, each one, every individual had an opportunity to ask any and all questions that we wanted to ask. And then finally, Joe would say, is everybody happy? Are we ready for the vote? Mm-hmm. And then we'd say, Sarah, and say, all right. If you were the applicant, you would say, I want a determination or answer on a negative. So in other words, if anybody said no for your appeal, what was your reason? Mm-hmm. That was the killer. You needed to think about that for a second. And the way it worked is you didn't have a lot of time. Mm-hmm. So your decisions were made during the conversation. Mm-hmm. And if you didn't ask a lot of questions, you may be voting kind of blindly, if you excuse the pun. I asked too many questions. That's why I asked the question, until what point are we actually leaving the Zoning Board of Adjustments authority and trying to do planning board work? Mm-hmm. Because the three major issues the planning board has, to me, they dropped the ball on all three. Made major poor decisions.
Mm-hmm. I think talk a little bit about the difference between a special exception, a petition for variance, and an appeal from the zoning board decision. I think the range of choices available to us is slightly different depending on what the request is.
Correct. Yes. And that's where you get narrowed down, is what the individual is trying to do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. As I understand the OSI manual, there is that part of that process of questioning is the hearing portion. But after the hearing closes, there should be an opportunity for for Sunny to say, well, gee, I don't understand. You know, why is it that we don't have this information? Mm-hmm. Or I don't think I can find that there's that the requirements for a special exception can be met because they haven't, shown something that the ordinance requires. And I think Deanna could say, well, I think there is information in the record because I heard the applicant say this. So I think there is an opportunity for that.
I think that's a very positive, because what I may have picked up on, she did, vice versa. And, you know, that's, but you gotta remember that, we never deliberated during public view. You deliberated within yourself.
Yep. And there's some of that that goes on. We don't, as nearly as I can tell, I don't think we have the authority to deliberate and exclude the public.
I do believe we should.
You do? Okay.
I do believe we can go into non-public session.
To deliberate?
To deliberate only. And then we can make, do a consensus, and if it's unanimous, fine. If not, then we can do a majority report and a minority report.
Okay.
I will confirm that. I have asked that question already, and I'm pretty sure. So I'll just confirm that.
Yeah, and it's something that we can ask when we get the training too. Because if I'm wrong on that.
Because it's very important that we are able to discuss things that we don't understand in non-public session. Only because, not because we don't want the public to know, but because we will actually gather more information and we might come to a different conclusion than we would have if you just gave up the cuff like we would know what we do if we just said, hey, well, I really don't know, I'll just vote yes, or I don't really know, I'll vote no.
Well, it seemed that that would follow the general courts.
Yeah.
Way of doing things.
Yeah. Yes. Because exactly the courts go into deliberation, non-public session. We had the county go into non-public session, and we did it at the state house too, so.
So when you exec a bill, you're in non-public session for that?
When we were at, in Concord, no.
No.
We would go into, you know, we'd be public most of the time. But there were cases where we could go into non-public session.
Okay.
And discuss whatever. Depending on what the issue was, if it had something to do with personnel thing or something like that, we could go into non-public.
Absolutely, yeah.
So, and basically at the county, we can go into non-public session for a variety of things. And I did have that discussion with the county attorney, so I wanted to know, I have the right to know law, how.
Right. That's the control.
Exactly. Yeah. So whether or not we had that available to us, because as we talked last week, I came out of here with the impression that we didn't have that. So I wanted to clarify that.
That's been my impression. So
I'll let you know as soon as Tom gets back to me.
And I will also, I think we can also raise it as a question when the Municipal Association attorney comes.
I was going to get a copy of it, but it's 110 pages. I figured, you know, we probably didn't want to read that tonight.
Thank you.
Yeah.
But I'm happy to download the electronic copy and share it.
And Charlie, do we know who from the Municipal Association is going to be doing the training?
Margaret.
Okay.
Do you know Margaret Byrne?
I don't, but possibly, you know, if we have specific questions, we might let her know so she can come prepared.
Absolutely. and that can be, I think that can be definitely part of what we do tonight.
Okay, perfect.
Make sure that we have a good list of questions that we want her to be prepared to ask. So question number one is, can we, how does deliberation work? Question two, can it be done in non-public session? And question three would be, what process is required to go into non-public session?
And at what length?
So have
do we have 1, 2 days, 3 days, 4 days?
We have 30.
Well, yeah.
Hold on one second. So how does deliberation work?
Sorry.
Let's see. Can it be done in non-public session? And three, what process is required? So typically there's a finding that had to be made in order to go into non-public session. Does planning
I'm so
board?
Sorry.
No, that's
fine. I had to bring my son to the airport at like 6 in the morning this morning, so I've been up forever. Can it be non-public session, and then the third was?
What's the process?
What is the process? Okay.
Thank you.
And then you were going to ask me.
Does the planning board ever go into non-public session for deliberation?
No. And I know from, I mean, this is totally different, but like in the trustee meetings, there's certain topics that are non-public, but generally, you're sort of, you can't just go into a non-public session because you don't feel like talking about a subject in front of people. And I don't know if that applies to this also. Because I do think the applicant, from what I've seen, and I'm sure you might agree, is, you know, the applicant has a right to hear what your
write them, that would be part of the way that would come out of our session.
Right.
Be in writing as to what had transpired.
Right. But if you're going to put it in writing, like, why wouldn't you just talk about it?
I think one of the...
I guess what I get really confused about is when the lawyers are brought in. It's not your fellow neighbor that we're talking about, where things can actually be easy. Mm-hmm. You know, you can actually hold the discussion back and forth. That's really easy. As soon as the attorneys get brought in, the language has to change, the demeanor has to change. It ain't good. That's all I'll say.
Not necessarily, because we're setting a precedence on some of these things. I mean, there could very well be issues where there has been a past precedent set on it. We don't have that institutional knowledge, so we don't know it. And if you're able to deliberate and say, look, let's check the records to find out if there is something on the books that already says that we should be doing this or we shouldn't be doing that or whatever. And that's what the deliberation would be, as to getting actual facts, as to getting more information for your decision. I mean, just because you say, oh, well, you know, they want to build this 6-foot fence, and sure, it sounds like a good idea, it's not in my neighborhood. That's not a good policy at all.
Let's see what we can find out about it. There are good arguments, obviously, on both sides, and
the law is going to... Well, we come up with a law, so...
Yep, it's 91A, the right to know.
Yeah.
Other questions or concerns, for now, related to the rules of procedure, but... we can certainly include anything that we believe we want additional education from the municipal association attorneys.
There is also a chance for follow up too after we have the presentation. If we have further questions, send on note or letter. So it's not like we have to think of all these things right now.
Yep, that's right. And one of the things that I recall reading in the OSI manual was that when the hearing closes, the applicant stays, and that's why I had the impression that it was that the deliberation was in public, because there may be follow-up questions that the applicant doesn't necessarily, the applicant or the abutters or the select board, maybe there may be questions that we would want to ask and get additional information. They don't necessarily have a right to demand equal time or make additional presentations for the board. That's what we request. Are there time frames that, so if we get an application on the first of the month, do we have to have a hearing within a certain period of time?
I believe it's within 10 days.
Of receiving the completed application?
Mm-hmm. Although our board, because we don't meet on a regular schedule, there is some wiggle room.
Okay.
Because you have to have, you know, you could say it has to be within 10 days, but if you can't gather enough board members within 10 days, there has to be some...
You have to be able to...
Understanding.
Okay. But you can't say, oh, I have an application, let me wait 60 days to get started. Would you have to...
No.
You have to begin the process of getting it.
Right. Historically, the way it's worked is the applications come in and then, like, we work to try to find a mutually agreeable date. And sometimes that is further out because both parties, you know, that the applicant can't meet when the board can meet. It's in this town, it's less formal than in other towns that have set, like, the ZBA meets twice a month.
And they know that on both of those meetings, they're going to have a couple of items of business.
Right, yep. Exactly.
Okay. So does the 10 days of proceeding to the application, does that include the certified mail notice to the abutters?
Well, that's exactly what it is.
Okay.
So
that's the 10 days.
Yeah.
It's just the notice to the abutters.
Yeah.
Okay.
So the I forget where it is. It's in that big manual. It said that the chair can call a meeting. You only have to get 10 days notice.
Yeah, that's 10 days. Let's see, 10 days notice is a little different from...
10 days in receipt of the application.
Okay.
Yeah.
I don't know 100% those numbers because it's never been something that I've had to follow just because of the sort of more casual nature of this board, just the way that I'm sure.
As I've gone through this, I've tried to highlight things. There are so many things I've highlighted.
We do have a time limit. If the planning board makes a decision, there's a period of time in which the applicant, if the applicant or the abutters don't like the decision, they have to file the appeal to us within a certain period of time. So far, I haven't found. If there is a time frame to do it, I'd like to find it. So, all right. Any other questions about the procedural rules?
In the OSI handbook, Charlie, it actually does say on page 1-5 under rules of procedure that the board's rules of procedure should cover issues of internal organization and conduct of public business. And one of those such things is the application decision process is the actual primary, and then under that is filing the application, notification of the public, conducting the hearing, decision voting. So it sounds like that's something that can be covered in our rules of procedure. Okay. If my reading of this is accurate.
I'm having a vague memory that you're right and I'm looking at it now. So, okay. Sarah, I forget how we noticed up. This is a workshop meeting?
Yes.
We do have a quorum. And our requirements for adopting rules, we just have to give public notice of a meeting. So I think we can adopt rules if we're ready. If we're not, we can wait till we have a meeting, a regularly called meeting. My concern is that we may get applications fairly soon. And I would like to not be worried about whether we do or don't have a set of processes, procedural rules that we can point applicants and abutters and the select board to.
So. Do you know something coming, Joe?
I have a sense that there may be something coming. I don't have the formal package yet. So there may be more than one thing coming. But it's one of those things where I think that municipal officials may have some informal conversations with applicants or potential applicants, but they don't have the application yet, which is different from. But it's one of the reasons why I'm asking: when the application hits us, do we have an obligation to act within a certain period of time? Does that make sense?
Yes.
So as of right now, our procedure policy does not contain anything with regard to that. So are you comfortable? So are you saying you want to vote on this? Are you comfortable doing that without that included?
For now.
So do we have the ability to amend these?
Yes.
Okay.
We have the ability to amend these anytime that we, again, have a publicly noticed meeting and we discuss the change to the rules.
Okay, so we can include that once we determine if there's a set number of days or.
Yeah.
Okay.
And my intention is to be diligent if and when we receive an application. My intention is to get things in motion to work with Sarah and Caroline to get us together to begin to get the hearing set up.
So in this it says a reason.
fits into procedures. But what happens if we need outside source?
You mean like legal advice or?
Well, it could be legal advice, but say engineering. Applicant comes in, he's got his engineer. The engineer says, that's fine. Right? Now, do I feel like I'm a qualified engineer? Absolutely not. Could he be blowing smoke up my? Yes. But could he be honest? Yes. A verification. Now, who fits the bill on that, and how do you handle that? Good question?
It's a good question. We don't have a budget to hire our own engineer.
I would actually think this would all be a pass-on cost to the applicant. So what we would need to do is to find some engineer that has nothing to do with the case and doesn't really work with the guy. Okay, bring him in. Simple question. Is this or is this not an acceptable engineering standard? And if he says no, are you going to help him answer your question or how are you going to vote?
Let me take a look at it. Maybe we should add that to our list of questions for Margaret. She's going to have a busy night. But it's a good question, and I've seen something written on it. But I think some of what I recall reading, Sonny, we're a small town. So if, say in Dover, if Hannaford comes in with a proposal to do something and Shaw's doesn't want to see it happen. Shaw's is the abutter. Shaw's may have its own engineer and the abutter may have its own engineer to poke holes in Hannaford's application.
Absolutely.
But often in Rollinsford, we don't have that situation where abutters
bring it. I agree with that. It's like we're not publicly elected officials either.
Right. I recall reading something, but I don't know that there's.
Only once we got outside source. Joe got us an attorney, and that was not open to the public.
Right. The Vice Legal Counsel is not open to the public.
And the attorney. And basically, we were facing an applicant with an attorney, you know, this big team. Right? Here's five guys. They work regular jobs.
Were you intimidated?
No.
Good. You shouldn't be.
No. You know how I'd answer that question? You put your pants on the same way I do.
That's true. All right. So, Deanna, I am seeing on page 75 of 160 of the OSI manual, which is page 3-24.
Okay.
That's okay, but you might just write down a note to do you have an electronic copy of it?
I have a book at home. Just okay. Look at the page again, I'm sorry.
It's okay, it's 3-24.
Okay.
And says the board may only enter into non-public session for those reasons contained in 91A32. The board would rarely, if ever, need to consider or act on any matters that would warrant entering into non-public session, with the exception of the need to consider legal advice.
We do have the right to do it if we feel it's necessary.
Well, it's. I'm good. I'll go take a look at 91A3, paragraph 2 contains the purposes that you can have a non-public session. Okay. Dismissal, promotion, or compensation of a public employee. No. Hiring of any person. Maybe if we have the ability to hire somebody, but don't usually have that ability. Matters that would adversely affect the reputation of any person other than a member of the public body itself. Not sure that land use stuff is emotional, but I'm not sure that it affects people's reputations. Consideration of the acquisition, sale, or lease of real property. We aren't doing any of that. Consideration or negotiation of pending claims or litigation. That's lawsuits. Considerations of applications by the adult parole board. No. Considerations of security-related issues bearing on the immediate safety of security personnel or inmates of the county state correctional facilities. Consideration of application by business finance authority, no. Considerations of matters related to the preparation for and carrying out of emergency functions, no. Consideration of confidential commercial or financial information that is exempt from disclosure under 91A54. It's possible that we would have financial information, but not probably not that usual. And then school boards considering tuition contracts, considerations of legal advice. So we may not have the ability to go into non-public session. It doesn't mean that we can't deliberate. I think it does raise all of the concerns that Sunny shared with us, particularly if there are attorneys in the room, where they can. My feelings are beyond being hurt with people's complaints about lawyers, but lawyers.
Sorry, Charlie. Please don't take it personal.
No, it's okay. But yeah, we can say things that cause lawyers to twist it around and say,
"See, ruffle feathers that you don't want ruffled." Yeah.
You were biased from the start because you said whatever.
Right. And you want to be able to speak freely.
Yeah.
And, you know, and we have questions and, you know, need to discuss it.
Let's see. I can't think of how we would ask the question of Margaret, but let's talk with, we've already asked her the question, can we go into non-public session? And she may have some suggestions for us about how we do that. Because I think all of your concerns are well placed and well said. On the one hand, we have an obligation to be transparent so the public understands what we're doing. On the other hand, we don't want to create liability for the town because we make a comment that somebody misinterprets or uses to say that we were somehow biased or that the fix was in or whatever.
I'm sure 99% of the time we won't have to do that, but I thought that we would check to see if we have the capability in case something happens, because I certainly don't want the town to be sued, and I personally don't want to be sued. I think that was part of the discussion last week.
Well, you have to know what your options are. Yeah. If they exist.
Yeah. If they exist. Yeah. And the part of the difficulty I think the select board appropriately cautioned me that, that in talking about getting training for us, I shouldn't spend any of the town's money without their approval. And I think I'm perfectly in support of that, completely in support of that as a taxpayer. But I guess part of what that makes me mindful of is that it does make it more difficult sometimes for us to say, we would like, be helpful if we could talk to an attorney about this. We're thinking, we've heard this testimony, but we aren't sure if the engineer is right. What are our options?
I'll bring up the condo project because you had the applicant's lawyer.
Yeah.
And over here you had the town's lawyer, mm-hmm. and it was Steve Roberts, mm-hmm. right? And you're listening to both sides, right? Well, the applicant is only narrowing in on few little fine pick details in this blue book, and he's not wavering. Of course, you're playing with Malcolm McNeil. He's very good at what he did. Very good. Yeah. I'll tell you, he almost got the approval. He was that close.
Is he a real estate attorney?
Yes.
He's very retired good. Now, but yeah.
He retired.
Yeah. I see him all the time.
Do you?
Generally ask when I go.
And honestly, my only concern is, I think the ZBA cases may become more complicated as things progress and as the building gets more difficult in town. So we need to be prepared. I'm not saying that all of the matters that come before us are gonna be these, terribly difficult cases, but I just would like to know, have the information ahead of time if we do find ourselves questioning.
Yep.
Okay.
We only had that happen once. There's a couple of ones there that, you really wonder which way do you go? You know, do you go public safety or, you know? And that's going to be up to the individual. It's whichever way you feel that you were swayed. And I'm not saying either way is right or wrong.
As we start looking at some of the materials that Attorney Radigan and Attorney Burns can share with us, there are some worksheets that are available. OSI makes a worksheet available that we can use at a hearing to kind of capture our thoughts and questions. So on the question of public interest, you know, what is it that the applicant has said? What is it that the abutter has said? What's the question that I need to answer for myself about that so that when I'm asked to take a vote, I know how I feel about the question of public interest. Forget the other criteria for variance, but there are ways that we can help ourselves by having an organized approach, and I'll make an effort to work that through.
Yeah, if I'm understanding this correctly, this person has already been through the zoning board, and it's been denied, right?
Mm-hmm. So, been through the planning board?
I'm sorry, the planning board. And it's been denied based on the rules of the town, or no?
Not necessarily.
Okay.
Necessarily.
So,
I think that's one instance of an application, but it's more common to want a variance from one of the zoning ordinances or a special exception to one of the ordinances.
Okay, so we have ordinances and the zoning board has, or the planning board has already declined. Well, how do they get to us?
Yeah, normally, like in Portsmouth, they would go to the planning board, submit the application, the planning board would deny them and refer them to the zoning board.
So for instance, like a recent case is pretty simple, is that a man wanted to put up an additional shed in his backyard that went into, that were too close to the lot line.
Okay.
So he needed a variance to the lot line ordinances in order to put his shed there. He had to come in and he had to show hardship in that there's no place else to put his shed. Various other reasons. He had supporting, like his neighbors said, like, we don't mind if he puts his shed there. Because there is the consideration, like, would us allowing this variance affect other people's property values?
Right.
So that's like a typical case. He wouldn't come for planning,
so he
because he wouldn't need to put it.
Okay.
He wouldn't need a site plan application,
okay,
or anything.
Okay.
Like that.
He only had a building permit rejection. He didn't even go to
the
planning board.
That's how a lot of the cases come to the ZBA,
okay,
through the building and
just
through the
building.
Select board,
yeah,
the building inspector.
Okay.
And sometimes a landowner will go to their attorney and say, you know, here's what I want to do, and the attorney will look at our town zoning ordinances and say, well, you'll need a variance from this position, from this ordinance, and you'll need a special exception from this ordinance. Let's start with the ZBA, because that's where we would get those things before we put the time and money into going to the planning board. And that's at least how it used to work. I don't know if it's still does that sometimes.
That's sometimes how it works, and
sometimes people do
get sent to the ZBA from planning and say, if you can't get this variant, special exception, whatever, we aren't going to be able to approve your plan because you don't conform to the ordinances. So they would go to the ZBA before they came.
And I think that's totally backwards. That's my thought. You need to present your plan to the planning board. They need to decide on what they are going to send to the ZBA. By rights, anything that doesn't meet, they should send. It should be more people.
Well, that's what they do.
They've acted on way too many things. They've waived too much stuff.
That's a debate.
They've waived way too much stuff.
Well, I think things have changed in town as well. But you have the zoning board adjustment make a decision. Your selectmen will not back you up.
Speaking from
experience.
We know that, don't we?
That could have been a really good lawsuit. It was years ago.
Well,
so,
getting back to the original thing, so it could end up here from either side. But if we act, we'll say the guy comes to us and there's two items. Mm-hmm. Well, there may be a third and a fourth someplace.
Third and a fourth item?
That needs to have a variance.
Oh, okay, yeah.
So when this guy comes to the planning board, right? I mean, the planning board's on the stick, they're going to say, no, take that to the ZBA and take that to the ZBA and take that to, then go back and see us. The rest is looking all right. But, I mean, you don't need to get into the nitty-gritty. He can still come in and talk to the planning board without any large expenditure.
There's something called a preliminary consultation with the planning board.
Right.
And often, at a preliminary consultation, they'll have a conceptual plan. And in the conversation with the planning board, that's where it looks like there's a 1, 2, 3, 4 items that need to go to the ZBA, and that's how you try to focus it.
And then, if you give them a variance, we'll say item A, it may have affected item D, and you didn't even know it at the time. So that's what I'm just saying. You know, that's why I prefer to see you go to the planning board
first. Yeah, it can be complex. One of the arguments that applicants make is that it's burdensome for them to pay the engineering and legal costs to do a full application. If they can't get the variance, then they don't want to have to sink all that money into the professional fees for something that can't happen. So it's a push and pull, and I think one of the things we hope as we do this work is that we'll get better and better at understanding the ordinances and asking the good questions and trying to see down the road a little bit. So what problems can we help the town and the applicant and the planning board anticipate and head off?
Do you need someone to make a motion to accept the rules, or do you make the motion? How does
I
this
do.
Work?
I think unless anybody thinks we should hold off to another meeting, I think we've noticed the workshop under 91A, and I think that I haven't looked back at the notice, but I think it was a workshop to talk about rules. Mm-hmm. So I think it's one of the things that we can do.
And you've satisfied me that if we want to change it, we can do so.
Okay.
Okay.
Should we
make a motion?
I
make a motion to accept the rules of procedure. One second.
Is there discussion on the motion to accept the rules of procedure as we develop them? Are we ready for a vote? Those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Those abstaining?
I support it.
Do I technically have a vote, even though I don't?
You don't, actually.
Okay.
Unless he was taking over from the
birth. I think in a workshop he does.
Mm-mm. Oh, really?
I think.
All he needs to do is be put in by that man right there.
But you have a quorum, so you don't need an alternate.
So if this was a public hearing, I think you could participate in the hearing.
But not actually vote.
Not actually vote. But I think at a workshop, I've read all these things once, I'm going to have to go back.
There's so much.
It's a pop quiz every night.
Doesn't matter. I mean, you really got enough.
Well, we do
it's
have
a good
more.
Question.
We do
it
have
is a good
more.
Question.
What we do?
Let me, I'll promise to go back in
okay.
the night. But for now, assume that at a workshop session, you will fully participate in it. Because we need you as much as we need any of the fully appointed members, because there could at any time we need you to be able to step in. So yeah, I think the more ways we can help you feel comfortable with the process, the better.
How many alternates do we have?
Two.
Ken and who else?
Paul has the alternate.
Oh, Paul is the alternate. Uh-huh. Okay.
Charlie, that's going to be something you really need to take a hard look at, especially in the summer, because that's where Joe really runs into problems. Guys, you know, hey, he's gone for this month.
Yeah.
Right? Now, can you get enough together?
Yeah. And I think our quorum is 3, so we have to have at least 3.
No, whether we were illegal or not, we heard a case, it was 3, just 3.
Mm-hmm.
I made a motion to hold it off another week till we got more people. And it was accepted. I'm surprised. I never had any kickback. But we had more members.
Yeah.
We had to bring them to speed rather quickly.
All right. all printed front to back, so it's different than they will look if we decide to adopt them. I don't know if, don't let me rush you into anything if you're not comfortable voting on something like this yet, but basically there are four different kinds of actions that we can take. One is an appeal from an administrative decision, one is an application for a special exception, one is a variance, and one is an application for an equitable waiver. And so the recommendation has been to break our single application that has three sections into four different applications. And then one of the forms may or may not be necessary. I think Sarah has been in the habit of preparing both personal and newspaper notices for people.
Yeah, C8 and C9. I mean, you can include them, but we have a... and this worksheet, I think, is just for personal use.
Yeah.
And then notices of decision granted or denied. We have a form, and actually the IBASIF. I should actually send you the last one I did and have you look at it and see if you think that there's something that needed to be adjusted to it.
Well, I for one have seen the old form that was being used, and I think it was a wonderful.
I have a
move forward.
An example of it here. It's hand typed. Beautiful typing.
I think from 1972.
Yeah, I think it is.
It's kind of awesome. The one thing that this doesn't seem to have is a place to put the abutters.
I thought there was a form for the abutters list, no?
I don't see one.
Maybe I didn't get it. There definitely needs to be an abutters list.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, my question on the abutters list is, I know in other communities, they were very hard and fast that the applicant was to provide the full list of abutters. And if it didn't include the full list of abutters, it was not an accepted application. Now, I know it's been very haphazard here in Rollinsford.
No, I send them back.
You do send them back now. Okay, good. So you've gotten tough on them.
Yeah, because... Because
I know in past people would submit them with no list of abutters and say, well, you guys put it together.
Oh, no. That hasn't happened. It's more that when I've actually gone and rechecked to make sure they've had all the abutters, they haven't.
They haven't.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I check, and actually now that we have the Map Geo, it's super easy for abutters to give us complete information. Because another lazy thing that people do is they were using that tax thing, and it doesn't have their mailing address.
Right.
So I would, go to Kevin, and Kevin would be nice enough to do it. But if you go to the wrong post person, they're like, no, this isn't. So you get them back, and then it's not properly noticed.
Right. Okay. I just wanted to make sure you were getting the complete information that you need.
No. Abutters and making sure that list is I love making sure that's correct.
Okay.
And also because Carolyn and I have worked out a way to identify the cases so that, because she gets back from the short list.
Right, on the, so, on the, yes. Okay.
No, that's the...
Just you the one that verified all the abutters and notified?
Yeah.
So there's actually basically there's no way one can get overlooked.
No.
And how far do you have to go?
So I just follow what the RSA says.
Was that 250 feet?
Yeah, it's across a road. I forget the exact, but yeah. Okay. Since this person, when I checked, he missed him better, so he's. The one thing I would suggest, and I don't know where you want to do this, is the ZBA fees are not listed really anywhere. So, we could talk about fees too. I mean, some towns...
That's what it should be.
Yeah, so some towns will actually charge a hearing fee. which would pay for, is this for me, for, you know, the cost is completely absorbed by the applicant. We do not charge a fee for the hearing. We just, within the last 2 years, I got everybody to okay, we raised the fee for the cost of the abutter so that it reflected the real cost of labor and sending them out, plus the real cost of newspaper notification. So I think this fee should be made more more readily available, and I think I truly, this is just my opinion, but I truly think that the board should consider a hearing fee. Because when I did all the research when we raised the fees, because I did for planning too. So I looked at fee schedules for a number of towns from our surrounding area, and the majority of them do charge, I mean, it's not a huge fee, but it is something.
Like, what are we talking? $50? Like, $150?
Like, from $50 up to $250, okay, for some of the bigger towns.
Okay.
You could get that marked on your tax bill, couldn't you?
Well, I just bring it up because when I approached the DBA about getting, at a meeting about getting, having a motion to have the fees accepted by the ZBA, Joe made the comment that it used to be volunteers who did my job, which is the truth. So if that's changed and now we have to pay for me, you know, maybe it makes sense for the town not to have to absorb that. I just bring that up as food for thought.
Let's go around the table.
I think that makes sense. I think that it's not an expense that the town should have to absorb. I think it is an appropriate expense for the applicant.
It seems like they're sort of going against what the town is saying, so there should be some cost for that, right?
I totally agree. Okay. I totally agree. I think what you'd want to do is, I think you'd want to list it separately, hearing fees, just a blank, so much. All right, and then, because you can't put a fixed fee on how many are you going to have to send out notices?
Well, it's per abutter. It's $10 per abutter, and the notification fee is an average of what our costs from Foster's have been.
Well, there again, you could actually list cost, and you could go cost plus 10%. Somebody's got to go to the post office. Mm-hmm. Now, is she getting paid to sit there and take notes, or is she getting paid as well to go to the post office to make sure this gets up?
Well, so the abutter fee, what we charge now, the cost of labor for me to go to the post office and all that is.
It's figured into,
yeah,
it?
Yeah, correct. So it's the real cost of certified mail plus labor.
I think it seems appropriate.
What I could do is, before we meet next for training, is I could go and I could do a comparison and let you know, like, so you can see some real numbers of like what League charges, what Madbury charges, what Dover charges, you know, like, all right.
And I think I want to finish getting around the table. And I think you already.
I went up the internet, I'm sorry. I do that often.
You're fine. I don't necessarily disagree. I do think it needs to be published. I think we need to have, you know, public rule, you know, amend our rules to include that. I'd like to get input from the select board on it, to see what their position is. I did, this is going back 30 years now, when I was on the planning board, I did sometimes hear the argument that taxpayers in town are already paying for town services and their taxes, and so the guy who wants to build the shed is already a taxpayer in the town, and the price of using his land as he would like to use his land is something that the town kind of shouldn't charge him extra for, I guess was, I'm not probably not being clear on the argument, but that was the argument that I used to hear in terms of either waiving or keeping fees low. I guess there was sometimes an argument that fees might be an effort to discourage people from taking advantage of the processes of planning board or the zoning board of appeals. I guess speaking personally, though, I share the view that you all share, which is that there are real costs associated with having these processes in place, and your contribution of time is an enormous contribution to the people of the town, but it's not fair to expect you to contribute the pretty specialized services that you contribute in terms of note taking and keeping track of all of the legal stuff that we have to do. And if we don't do that stuff right, there's not going to be any goodwill wasted on the town for that. So, but I do want to hear from the planning or from the select board in case they have adopted a policy that says no, let's go light on the fees and so forth. At the university, we can't levy fees on people for things that we do. It's the student pays tuition, and we serve the student within the tuition that the student pays. So I'll double check that. But if you would go ahead and prepare a comparison and maybe identify for us what you think is a reasonable fee based on your experience, Sunny.
And just to cover, your costs. I mean, if it's a net zero, to me, it shouldn't cost, and I see your point about costing the taxpayers, but, if it can be a zero net cost to the town, I think that it's a win-win.
Yeah.
Can we split it up into two types of fees? One for a resident, one for a non-resident? The reason I'm saying that,
Go ahead, finish the thoughts. Then I'll say no.
A resident has already paid taxes here, all right? So we'll say you need a variance of something and you got to mail all this out. Now, I don't live near you, but I'm going to pay part of that cost, right? But you are a resident. Now, he comes in with John Q or whatever company, and he's going to buy this building from her, provided he can get all of this. Well, I definitely don't want to pay a dime for his stuff. He wants it. It's a commercial venture. You foot the entire bill. Now, I can see you're totally different from me, and I welcome that.
Yeah, I disagree too.
Well, you can disagree.
Yeah. I don't think we can treat residents and non-residents differently, in part because it's a landowner. And so taking your example, we don't charge you as much, and you get the approval, and then you flip it to Ken, the non-resident, and pocket the money and go away happy. So residents can game that system, in order to engage our process, it has to be a landowner, so they have to own the land in the town. And so because they own the land in the town, they are taxpayers, even if they aren't residents.
They don't have to be a resident, they are a taxpayer.
So, I'm happy to look into it for
a second. That's where I really differ. Now, if you own an apartment building, but you do not live in Rollinsford, right? You shouldn't have as much to say as the people that live here. Mm-hmm. Well, one thing's for sure, you certainly don't deserve to have a dumpster.
What we have here.
A dumpster?
Yes. Don't get this down. Yeah. Absolutely not.
Okay. So anyway, before we digress down that road, I'll check into it, but I don't think you can.
Well, probably not.
So that's hearing fees, and I'd say let's not plan to adopt forms tonight. It sounds like we want to only adopt the application forms. It sounds like the form that we use, the individual board member variance worksheet, I think that ought to be publicly available, even if we don't formally adopt it. Just in the interest of transparency, and I do think it's a helpful, but we probably need to have an additional separate worksheet for special exception.
Yep.
And we also need a form on a butter.
Yes. And does it specifically, I don't see where it says specifically on here that they need to provide the labels. Is that just, do we have an information sheet when people are submitting an application, or should that be included?
I mean, I would love to have it included. I'm not sure because often Caroline is the one who's handing out these applications, so I'm not exactly sure. I don't think in the zoning ordinances or submission.
Perhaps,
Charlie,
we could add an information sheet that could pertain to all of these forms that with the list of abutters needs to be submitted with all of the forms as well as the appropriate labels.
Yeah. So when I was looking at revising it, I looked at Dover's, and Dover has like a checklist. So application checklist.
Maybe we can
with
use
the
that.
Fees and everything that they want.
I like that.
With the addition of that, I think that would be terrific.
Yeah, and I think it also gets at that point of residents of the town who come to the zoning board aren't our opponent. They are, they're citizens of the town, taxpayers of the town, and my view of a process like this is we want to make it as accessible and as open and as fair as we can think of to make it. And so having a clear checklist that says, here's, in order to go forward, here's what we need.
Yeah.
That makes a lot of sense to me. Okay.
Charlie, how does a judge override a zoning board decision?
The judge can find that the zoning board on, let's take a variance first. There are a number of ways that they could do it, but they can find that we didn't follow the right procedure. So if our procedure says that we deliberate in open session and we go into closed session, if our rules of procedure say we have to do it this way, and we go into closed session, and let's say it's not for legal advice, they could find that we didn't follow our process. That's one way. Another way is...
So that would be an automatic to have that variance waived and get approved?
Not necessarily, no, because the judge might send it back to us to do it again. You know, say, no, you have to hear it again, and you have to, you have to follow your process this time. The judge could find, say we've determined that hardship was present, and I forget the other elements of a unnecessary hardship was present. Values of surrounding property would not be diminished, and it was reasonable to grant the waiver, but we found there was no unnecessary hardship. And if the judge said, no, the board applied the unnecessary hardship test wrong, the judge could reverse. And that might be the situation where the judge would say, well, the evidence was legally sufficient to find unnecessary hardship. The board found all of the other things necessary to grant a variance, so I'm going to grant the variance. A third, that really is the constitutional test as well. Oh, say there's a statute that governs the variance process, and there's something in the statute that says, you know, we have to meet on the second Tuesday of the month or something like that, and we meet on Wednesday instead of on Tuesday. The judge could find, I'm making this up, obviously, but if we violate the statute, the judge can overturn us. The thing is, though, if an abutter is unhappy with us, if we grant the variance and an abutter says, there was no unnecessary hardship there, the board, you know, the ZBA made a mistake, the abutter can take us to Superior Court, too.
I understand that, right.
Yeah.
But what I'm referring to is specifically that condo case,
yeah,
that the Superior Court judge came back and said that we we're all wrong. Mm-hmm. All five of us were wrong.
They can say that. You know, I don't recall why. Was it on the process or was it on the application of the...
No, release? They seem to think that it was legally allowed to be done in that area.
Okay.
And what had happened is there again. That's right. You know, I was talking about lawyers. The decision that we made to go no was actually presented by the town's attorney. Mm-hmm. Right? So here we are. I mean, I didn't see the difference between that and being a jury. You made a decision, right? How can one guy say he's got more smarts than the five of us? I just didn't like that. I mean, yep. He could have sent it back and said, you need to reconsider, this is why, mm-hmm. and give us a shot, rather than just saying, you guys are wrong. Yep. That's pretty easy.
Different Superior Court judges take different approaches to how they handle that, too. So it's one of the possibilities is for them to remand. We can certainly ask that question of Margaret.
Well, I mean, and I agree. I think you're going to start seeing a lot harder issues coming forth. I mean, like I told you last time, look at that case in Rochester. Mm-hmm. The residents are suing the Zoning Board of Adjustment because of that cell tower issue.
Yep. No, it's... move on to what days we have available to meet, and I'll go back in and get, I haven't heard from John, but I can try to reach John. So,
John, kind of.
No, John Hinsman.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. No, I did explore whether we could get free training from John Radigan, who's represented the town on some planning issues, and he indicated that he could provide us some of these materials. If we try to provide a low-cost consultation course if we had additional questions. I also approached John Krebs, who is the planner for the planning board, and he indicated he didn't feel he could help us out. I forget who else I approached, but then Caroline found the online, the Municipal Association for $550 will meet and train us for 2 hours and answer our questions, and that we can submit a list of questions to help them prepare and so forth. So the select board felt that was a good way for us to go, and kind of on their own motion approved the money for us to get the training. So that planner is not available on the 25th. It's only the 11th and 18th that are possible dates. There was an email late in the day that indicated that.
Oh, the person's not available the 25th.
The person is not available on the 25th. So, Andrea, which of those two remaining days are you available?
The 11th, I will, whatever is decided, I can change my schedule on the 18th. The 11th is preferred, but if the 18th works for everybody else, I will make some adjustments.
Sunny? I'd like the 18th. Caroline left a message on my phone and asked about the 18th, and I haven't got back to her. I figured it was going to come up tonight, and it did.
And before we go tonight, can I get your phone number and address so that I can... You have an answering machine?
Yeah. What you think of that?
Do you not have email?
Yeah, I just choose not to share it.
We're gonna keep sweet talking, and eventually he will share it with us. And you and I can plan to meet. I'm happy to.
You like that?
I'll make it work, whatever it is.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
Shall we? What?
The 18th, I can't do.
I just got a double check.
And Paul did say that he could do the 18th. I know he was available the 18th. I thought he said he was available all 3 dates today, but I think Charlie had some other information.
I'm sorry.
Paul.
Oh, yeah, what did Paul
say? I thought that he said he was available all 3. I saw him today and I asked him that.
I'm available the 18th and the 25th. I have a stormwater meeting on the 11th. So.
like the 18th is the day.
Even though Municipal Association currently is saying to us now, they don't have somebody. Oh, it looks like it would be Steve Buckley on the 11th or Margaret on the 25th. They have another, they have a different webinar scheduled on the 25th now, so that's... Okay. John is the one that we don't know. Okay. All right. Caroline has been a lot of help in trying to nail that down.
Is it looking like the 18th?
You know, Mr. Charlie, I think you need to get everybody regardless of what day it is. And that's going to be a difficult process.
That's going to be a difficult process. Maybe they'll let us tape it. Let's see what we can do. Let me ask that. My concern, Sonny, I agree with you. Except, I'm worried that we will get an application, and
it's going to happen.
It's so many of us are new. I'd like to be sure that there are at least three of us that feel comfortable in the in the roles that we're being asked to play.
You presently do have three right now.
John and Paul.
And yeah. Paul.
Yeah, it's possible. Let me.
I mean, I'm not saying it's going to be easy.
Yeah.
And
I would like to have the training before we have, if we can.
Because
I'm one of the newbies, so I know I would personally.
The problem is there's going to be a million questions.
The 18th.
There are always a million questions, and one of the things that we can take comfort in, you're all energetic, you're all bright, you're all willing to put some time into this process. We're going to get better at it. So, how many years ago was that condo thing? More than 10 now, isn't it?
Jesus, I don't know. It's been a while.
It's been a while. Because I worried about that for years afterwards. We worry about our mistakes a lot. We're just human. We are public servants, volunteer public servants, doing the best we can. And so, I really appreciate, like, I was worried initially, like, can I really schedule a workshop? Because, the board had been used to meeting only at the call of the chair, only to handle appeals. And you all have given me, what, three nights already to talk about these things? So I don't want to impose on you, but I really appreciate how interested you are in getting it right. And we're going to find a way. We'll get the information that we need, and we'll keep working.
What type of thing might be forthcoming? Do you even have an idea?
I have an idea that it could be a petition for variance and a petition for an equitable waiver.
What do you mean by equitable waiver?
Well, funny we should mention that. Let's take a look at what an equitable waiver is. Because it is something fairly new.
Huh.
Let's see. Sonny, I was going to blame you because you asked the
all
questions.
The questions, Sonny.
I'm trying to help you newbies out.
We're going to blame Sonny early and often. I just think turnabout is fair play. He started it on the lawyers.
Boy, well, I'm sorry, but it's not personal, but you better remember.
So at page 12 to 13 of these slides, so they call it the honest mistake exception. There's a statute, 674.33. I think it only relates to setbacks. Mathematical or dimensional requirements, that's really setbacks or like square footage requirements, that kind of thing. And it's, the conditions are, there was a violation, it was not noticed or discovered until after the structure was built, or until after, let's see, a lot or other subdivision of land in violation had been subdivided to a bona fide purchaser for value. So, so if you had a, say somebody created a lot that was less than 2 acres in the part of town that requires a 2 acre minimum for a buildable lot, and that the somehow the planning board approved it, and it got recorded in the registry of deeds, and then a purchaser bought the land, the town could grant an equitable waiver to the purchaser of the property because they could no longer cure that problem, and it wasn't their fault, and nobody noticed it until after it had been built. Years and years ago, when when Stockdale Circle was built, there was a foundation that was put in, maybe more than one foundation that was put in too close to the lot line.
That was on my street.
Was it
Heritage Drive?
It was Heritage Drive?
Yep.
Okay.
They made a movement.
They made, yeah, and an equitable waiver might be, it was set up to.
They had to put the whole house and everything.
Yeah.
The foundation.
And there are some conditions on there. You know, somebody can't try to set up the conditions so that they can later on try to get an equitable waiver. And then there's the violation does not constitute a public or private nuisance, nor diminish surrounding property values, nor adversely affect any present or permissible future use of the property, and the cost of correction far outweighs any public benefit to be gained by the cost of requiring that correction. So in the Heritage Drive case, say it was a 6-inch violation of the setback rule, the cost of moving the whole house, you know, caving in the old foundation and pouring, you know, setting up the forms and building a new one, would cost a lot more, and it might not really impact neighbors' values very much. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, if it was right on the lot line, and you know, now arguably it does impact the neighbors, the value of the neighbor's lot, and it could impact future uses of the both non-conforming lot and the neighbor's lot. So it sounds like we've never had an equitable waiver come before the Zoning Board of Appeals yet. It's a fairly new statute.
Yeah, it wasn't called that. I'm trying to think what it was. It was an error made by somebody.
Okay.
And one of the dimensions was off. It's a tough one to call because if the guy that did it, it was the guy to come up and explain what happened. All right, so you got all the info. So, I mean, you can sit there and just say, hey, you know, the big company's just here to make a dollar. The guy admitted, I made a mistake.
Mm-hmm. So I think they can be fairly technical because sometimes computing setbacks, like if the road has a curve, so say on the cul-de-sac where there, you know, there's a round turnaround, the setback is computed with this mathematical formula. It's geometry, and I didn't do particularly well with geometry. I apologize. So I have to kind of nod when the engineer or the land surveyor says it does or does not meet the setback requirements. So sometimes it can be tough, or with oddly shaped lots.
Right. Are these homes already constructed, Charlie? Are these situations where the home exists and it's now been determined?
Or the lot exists.
And so they're trying to build a structure and they can't meet the setbacks? Okay.
Yep. or they, again, it could, dimensional requirements could be a lot that has, in certain parts of town, a lot must be at least 2 acres, and I forget what percentage has to be a buildable, you know, if there's a steep slopes and wetlands are deducted from the area.
Right.
Whether or not it meets the requirements. So all of those things could be a factor. But usually there is an intervening purchaser, and usually the person who is seeking the waiver isn't in a position to correct it, or the cost of correcting it is considered to be, what was the word? Anyway, there was the test in here.
Okay.
So those would be the questions that we would look at in the, you know, the applicant would tell us why the applicant thinks it meets the standard for equitable waiver.
Mm-hmm.
Abutters or, I don't know that the board, select board often appears at ZBA hearings, but I believe that they can. They have. They can say that they don't think the requirements are met. We can ask questions, and our questions would really be focused on, you know, trying to figure out if the thing that the statute says has to be met, whether those elements are present in the case or not. That would help us guide us where our questions should be.
No, I'm just not
going to
ask my questions. We'll be here forever.
She knows it's 8:29. She's thinking, I already know how I'm going to vote when I'm asked if we want to extend the loan.
That's what I mean about complicated.
Can be.
Yeah.
Yep. Can be. And we do have to, you know, kind of ask which statute applies. I'll try to be helpful with that. The applications, one of the reasons to go to, I think, newer applications is the applications also help to identify for us, oh, we should look at the statute as we're going through the hearing or before the hearing to get a sense of what must be met for us to grant the requirement.
When will you make a decision on the training?
I'll work with Caroline tomorrow.
Okay.
Actually, I'm going to be on the road for work tomorrow. It may not happen until Friday.
That's fine. And he'll email us the decision.
Okay.
It sounds like the 18th is going to be the prevailing day.
I think the 18th is the prevailing day.
Okay. I would just like to change my plans sooner rather than later.
You can show up the 17th. How's that?
You know this stuff.
We're
need the training.
You can watch it at home on the night. Yeah.
You've been doing this stuff.
Sunny's going to film me.
I'd be more than happy to.
He'll email you.
I can do that.
Sarah will have a one-word
reply. That super secret email.
Gotcha.
I'll set up a new email account and then move it in from there.
Actually, I'm going to call Sonny's home phone, and he's going to leave me a message every day on his answer phone. A little more each day.
Hey.
Are we having that meeting?
Yes, we're done.
Yeah.
We're done.